Greetings and welcome to another edition of Berks Perspectives. I'm Chuck Gallagher, and with me today are three brave souls who braved the snow piles along North 13th Street and the sundry roads in the city and county. Unfortunately, our fourth member, your fourth member, chose instead to be among the flowers at the flower show in Philadelphia. I can't imagine why she would prefer flowers to the three of you.
There were six other days of the week she could have been there.
Yeah, what's up with her?
Highly trained professionals that we are.
Yes. Absolutely. Ruth Martelli.
Good morning. Oh, no, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Fred Levering.
Chuck, it's always nice to see
and
you.
And the day before Patty's Day, Opalinski.
Opalinski. Yes. I have occasionally gotten mail with an O apostrophe P, believe it or not.
That would be interesting.
Yes.
You and St. Patrick.
And because my name ends in an I occasionally get things from Italian groups that just assume that it ends in an I must be Italian.
Well, St. Patrick,
those vowels.
St. Patrick was Italian, wasn't he?
Boy, that's a good question.
I believe he was Italian. And the Spanish pirates abducted him and took him to Ireland.
Sounds like the makings of an opera.
Sounds like the UN.
Yes, maybe.
Speaking of the UN.
No, he actually accomplished something.
We should talk about the havoc that Stella has wrought. The spring storm, well, almost spring storm, naming Stella. You object to them naming storms by Christian names or any
name.
It's
supposed to be reserved for hurricanes. I don't understand this at all. But it's
being the traditionalist that you are.
That's right.
But how did we all fare with Stella?
Well, she packed a wallop, but it could have been worse. I mean, I think it was much worse in New England.
Well, that's my mother's favorite saying. It could have been worse. And her name is Stella.
Did she say that after looking at you? Or
I rather think so. That's two. Quickly, will you take, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think where they got it worse is where people know better than the rest of the country how to handle snow in quantity.
Like Buffalo, New York? Mm-hmm.
It was very, though, heavy, and it shifted. It got some sleet in the midst of it, and it was a very difficult snow to remove.
As you pointed out, it was difficult on the roads where the cars were packing it.
Yeah. At least for our area, I think the forecaster seemed to get it pretty much right. I mean, it started when they said it would start, and the accumulation was about what they said it would be, and they talked about the possibility of it being a mix, and
all of it.
So all
true.
Of that was right. Yeah,
we give them an A.
They get paid this time. Yes.
Okay. Speaking of getting paid, the Reading Area Water Authority, again, they're continuing to take a look at who they've been billing and who they haven't been billing. And we got several $1 million that's kind of out in the ether there. But it sounds like they've got some good response from the people who owe the money, and it'll be interesting to see what happens.
What really annoys me about it, frankly, is, you know, it seems unconscionable that some of these big users got a pass. I mean, whether it was through negligence, or I certainly hope it wasn't intentional.
You think they might wonder why they never got a water bill.
In the meantime, there are, you know, Joe homeowner or some little old lady in her row house is getting
$100 a month,
is getting clobbered and told that she has to be thrown out and going to have her water shut off because she missed one payment. I mean, that's really hard to swallow.
A lot like the budget that just came out today and the new
healthcare local stuff here.
But that same argument could be writ large in terms of stuff going on nationally.
Who gets it and who doesn't, right?
I want you to write down what you said, because the same little old lady who's getting thrown out for a water bill is going to lose her health care and won't have Meals on Wheels. Of all the things you can cut, Meals on Wheels for seniors?
I do my part. I deliver the stuff.
Yeah, well, you're not going to anymore because the program's being dismantled.
But he'll be doing it for free, maybe. As big-hearted as
he
is.
Is that what you're going to do?
That's right.
You're going to make peanut butter sandwiches and take them to the poor. I'm sure they'll
Speaking
be
thrilled. Speaking of big hearts, I hope Steve forgives me for mispronouncing his name. El Sayed El Marzouki.
Steve. The owner of this. You got the El Marzouki right, yeah.
Steve.
He goes as Steve.
But I think he prefers his Egyptian name. El Marzuki.
I think he,
Mr. El Marzuki.
I think he goes by Steve because the rest of us can't pronounce it very well.
Right, exactly.
God bless him.
He introduced himself to me as Steve.
Right.
So it's Steve as far as I'm concerned.
Well, that's because he knew you would not.
But he's agreed to go back and take over the Islamic Center. His predecessor, who actually succeeded him, just found it a little bit too much to deal with. But it's someone like Steve is a perfect choice.
I'm glad he came back from Egypt, first of all, in order because there was some talk that he might just stay. He was really pretty upset by the travel bans and other things. Yeah, it's good to have him back, and I'm sure the congregation will welcome him with open arms. But
since we broached Egypt, we can now talk about Brexit, the British exit from the EU, and the fact that the Prime Minister...
Egypt to England?
Alphabetical.
Doing the UN by the alphabet.
The UN by alphabet.
Albania is first.
Yeah, but
I don't know if it is.
Albanians haven't done anything.
I've always thought America was first.
Albania, not alphabetically, honey.
But the British evidently are going to go ahead and pull out of the EU. Prime Minister is ready to gear it up, and in the course of that. The Scots are saying, the Scots in Scotland, we just should not be with the UK anymore. So they may be taking a vote to pull out. The Dutch had a wonderful election today.
I was going to say, it'll be interesting to see what happens. What happened
with the Dutch?
You know what?
The far right were really, really pushing hard. But as a result, they haven't.
Didn't get it.
They didn't get it.
And so that may affect what goes on in France and there are what?
Hopefully.
A whole bunch of other countries.
You know what I heard last night that's really disturbing to me? This guy is really far right. What's his last name? Gert Wilders.
Right.
Is really far right. He was going to close all his borders. Prevent people of it, throw out all the Muslims, close his borders to everybody. But he was subsidized in his campaign by a lot of Americans who funneled their money into his run for the president, premiership, whatever it is that he was running for. I think prime minister.
Prime Minister Holland. Mm-hmm.
But a lot of American money was funneled into his campaign, which I found astounding.
Well, so much for that. It evidently didn't have any effect.
Well, last week people were in Holland were speculating that he was going to win. And something changed. Maybe that kind of knowledge that somebody was trying to influence the election from outside of the country.
Is this part of the fact that the Dutch and the Turks aren't getting along right now? Mm-hmm. Turkey's angry with Holland and Holland's...
But you know that because the Dutch were so worried about their election being corrupted in the ways that ours was undermined to some extent, everybody voted by hand on a ballot which was collected and hand tallied rather than doing anything electronically.
I thought they had always done the handwritten ballot.
No, I don't. Well, this time for sure they did it because they didn't want to run the risk of having any kind of problem with their election.
Well, the woman in France, Le Pen.
Le Pen, yeah.
She seems to be all right.
Well, I would imagine the same people who funneled money into Holland will do the same into France when their election comes around. And Germany as well, because there's no guarantee that the Germans aren't going to be nationalistic. They still have some...
Well, she's coming...
She's coming here.
Next week, I believe.
Angela Merkel. We're talking about Angela Merkel.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's Europe is definitely, definitely in... Not turmoil, but at least there's some things going on.
Well, there's the same
a lot of what's going on here.
Same nationalistic fervor there that we've been introduced to here. It's a little, it's frightening.
Well, the French have done quite a bit in terms of their jobs and things of that nature, aren't being allowed to warn in public and what have you. I think the French are probably in the forefront of that, keeping Muslim people segregated.
Well, I think that's their problem. If you segregate anybody, then you reap the benefits of the segregation. You can't ask people to blend into your society when you don't welcome them.
Well, you're creating ghettos.
Well, you are. Well, I think that's where a lot of discontent is bred. If you have people interacting with one another, then some of the fear is stamped out before it has a chance to grow.
a little closer to home, if I may. It seems the Marine Corps has been shaken up quite a bit by taking photographs of Marine females naked and spreading them all over, well, the internet, I guess.
On a site that's open to current and retired members of not just the Marine Corps, it turns out, but the other branches of the service. Some of those pictures were consensual, but a significant number of them, the women didn't know that they were being, that their photographs were being shared.
But what does this do to the image of the Marine Corps? I mean, the top Marine has come out very harsh and said this is not who we are.
Well, all you have to do is look at other stuff in society and you can see where women stand. So I don't think anybody should be shocked.
What I think is astonishing, though, is that somebody thought that somehow or another they were going to do this and not let it become public. I mean, it's not possible anymore.
But the thing that's really incredible and quite wonderful is that the person who blew the whistle is a Marine.
Yeah, she.
He.
Oh, he?
It was not a she, it was a he who I guess on the site saw women he knew wouldn't allow their pictures to be posted there, and he's the one who brought it all to light. It wasn't a disgruntled woman, it was a man who was eligible to be on that site and was just disgusted by what he saw.
Well, this again underscores what Fred has been contending, that the internet has created an awful lot of obstacles and opened an awful lot of dark doors.
Well, the doors have always been there. What the internet has done is opened them. And I'm not sure that opening the door on things that are dark and vile is a bad thing, because then you get to see who's dark and vile and you can take steps against it, as supposedly the Marine Corps is going to do.
But there's the other side of that, too. We're going to be opening places where dark and vile have never been exposed.
Well, but when
dark... And expose them, too.
When dark and vile are allowed to remain dark and vile, but accessible...
Ah, there's the accessible is the caveat.
The other thing, and I don't know that you have it on your list, but the other statistic that goes along with this is that the incidence of assault, sexual assault at the service academies has risen significantly in just a short period of time.
I think that's proportionate with the number of women they've allowed in, too.
Well, I guess if you're a guy, well, that's not true. I take it back.
And in that vein, the Marine Corps is part of the Navy. And the Navy just recently, one of the retired top admirals and a group of his officers have been accused of collaborating with contractors to get money, have parties, stay in motels, have big dinners. So you've got the Marine Corps with the salacious material, then you've got the Navy with this basically ripping off contractors, costing taxpayers thousands of dollars.
I think, I've said enough. Go, guys.
I heard an interview, a woman who's in the Air Force, who just came out with a book called Shoot Like a Girl, because one of the statistics is that women are better marksmen than men because they can control their emotions and focus more fully and all that kind of thing. But she, what shocked me was she talked about the fact that there is a significant amount of sexual harassment of males by males who are above them, not for sexual gratification, but as a way of showing who has the power over whom. And when she talked about that, I just it isn't just about women. It's about the
whole... It's a hierarchy, isn't it?
It is a hierarchy thing. And if you've got the rule that says you obey your commander no matter what, well, let's see how far that goes, and apparently, at least to some degree, that's a part of the way it works in the military as well.
And I'm sure throwing $54 billion more dollars at it will help solve all these problems.
That was being facetious,
yes,
I trust.
Yes, it was.
Yes, indeed. Again, your favorite topic, the internet. We've indicted 4 Russian spies for hacking Yahoo, I guess. Back in 2014?
Half a billion accounts worth, yeah.
And a billion before that. So 1.5 billion people who used Yahoo were hacked into.
Now, this shows that the Russians are capable of doing that. Now we've got the fact where, did they in fact hack into the DNC, the Democratic National Committee?
Well, we know
and
they
that's
did.
Pretty much a given now, is it not?
We know they did.
That's the question. What impact, if any, did it have on the election?
I just heard last night that one of the guys, one of those four men, two of them are hacks, and two of them are associated with the Russian spy network. Mm-hmm. And one of those two guys, who's on the poster, the wanted poster, mm-hmm. is the same guy who was at a meeting of this spy, whatever it is, I forget the initials. He was the one who somebody came in, put a bag over his head, yanked him out of the meeting, and he's now in prison somewhere accused of treason.
In Russia.
Mm-hmm. Happened in Moscow. So somebody who ran afoul of them somehow.
A double agent or something?
Well.
Working both sides? Yeah.
That's perhaps. What treason yeah. would imply, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
Well, now we can go to Fred's second favorite subject, the federal government. The flap over Mr. Trump's tax return. Now, one of the network people, or I guess not network, one of the cable company people, broke it, saying with the first couple of pages of his 2005 tax return, showing he paid, what, $35 million
yeah.
in taxes against $150 million earned and all that yeah. sort of thing.
I don't think it tells us much about anything.
No,
it's sort of a non-right.
There is speculation the fact that he himself may have released that to show what a good boy he is and how well he's handled things.
Or to have another two or three day news distraction,
but
perhaps.
But we are beginning to get, the lines keep getting blurrier and blurrier and blurrier. I think the most clear line was now come out where Mr. Trump, who accused Mr. Obama of wiretapping his pad up in New York, has finally had to come out and say, well, wiretapping, he hasn't apologized yet.
Well, and he says maybe in a couple of weeks some very interesting things will come out. And my feeling is, if he's got it, why do we need to wait? But I think he doesn't have it, and so we'll see. But
well, and if it's true that there's some sort of evidence of having been tapped or whatever,
or microwaved, yeah.
Well, or microwaved, then the supposition is, since the president couldn't ask for it, that another intelligence service did, in fact, have reason to suspect that somebody in Trump Tower was colluding with the Russians.
Oh, but they would have had to come out with probable cause in order to get a warrant. You
yeah.
just can't slap a warrant on there.
No, I didn't say you could. I'm just saying that if in fact that happened, the only way it could happen is if somebody within one of the 17 intelligence services had probable cause to record somebody in Trump Tower.
The probable cause is easy
Paul
to
Manafort,
track down.
Paul Manafort lives there or has an office
yeah,
there.
But you can track down that probable cause.
But that
cause
was not the question that was asked.
Yeah, I think the allegation was just a stupid thing for him to do. If he wanted to say, I have received word that there has been tapping or surveillance, but to blame the president, to call him sick, I mean, to be that specific, the president wiretapped Trump Tower was just absolutely asinine.
If I said,
wasn't there a rule that the buck stops here? I mean, if right. it happened on his watch in his administration.
Not if he doesn't have any evidence, and it's been 2 weeks and he has given nothing.
We are succumbing to this internet attitude here that everything has to be instantaneous. Let's let it
yes.
play out.
If you're going to impugn your predecessor, you had better have reason to do it. And that seems to be
And that's what
at
shocks
this point.
Me, that,
yeah.
that other people who perhaps voted for Mr. Trump and perhaps were opposed to Mr. Obama still aren't outraged that that this president is accusing another president of a treason.
Can we hit the rewind button here for a moment
sure.
and remember Obama, for God's sakes, through about 7 3/4 of his term, years, was blaming everything on George Bush. What the heck is the difference?
I mean,
it's all George Bush's fault. I mean,
well, the point here, I think, yeah, I agree with what you're saying, yes. And the predecessors do go back and say, the guy before me did the problem and all that. And in many cases, they're right. But in this case, when we come out and accuse a man of doing something that's very, very wrong.
Illegal.
Well, what do you do? He's the president. If I said that you did something untoward, that you were a serial robber or something like that, on public in this air right now, what recourse would you have?
None.
I think I could sue you.
Yeah?
Yeah, for defamation of character.
And can we sue the president for the same thing?
Not people in the public domain. And right. We're probably sitting here in the public domain right now.
Well, don't you dare think of it.
I was trying to think of it.
You know, Fred, I'm biased, but all the, for 7 3/4 years, President Obama said, this is the fault of George Bush.
I don't remember him ever saying
no,
that.
No, I don't either.
He blamed everything on Bush, for heaven's sakes.
Not him individually.
Well, it's interesting when you have the current president saying that he inherited a mess. Mr. Obama inherited a hell of a mess, too. I mean, you know.
He didn't. The country did was not on the
brink of collapse. Well, the economy was on
I'm
the
just saying,
of
they
collapse.
Both said the same yeah. thing. I mean,
yes, but in one case, it wasn't
Obama
true.
Got the economy, which was a mess.
Yeah, well, what
he
did
got
Trump
the
get?
Iraq situation, which was a mess.
What did Trump get that's a mess?
I don't know.
That he hasn't made himself.
Yeah. I didn't call it a mess. He did.
And I think he was wrong when he did it.
No, his mind and his budget today.
What was a mess were the policies that were followed were heading against the majority of the people's will.
I don't think that's true.
Otherwise, 3 million people wouldn't have voted for the other candidate.
Yeah, I just heard, I hadn't realized this until the other day, but that Trump actually got fewer votes than Romney. But because fewer people voted this election, which was really interesting.
Well, and the other thing that I don't know if this...
So not the majority.
No, it was not the majority. And one of the reasons why Democrats are going to have a harder and harder and harder time achieving office, at least on the state level, is because of gerrymandering.
Sure.
And finally, Fair Districts is coming through and really pushing. And in Virginia, the federal court just ruled against their gerrymandering as being racially based. So what the Republicans have done in states they control after every census is to draw, you said it, it was to keep somebody in office. Holden? No.
No, it was to get Jim Gerlach elected in the first place.
So those really have, and I say this all the time, I wish I knew if a class action suit could be filed by Democrats living in one of those districts.
But nobody
My vote has been abridged.
But
my
nobody
freedom.
Accused anybody of doing it for racial reasons, as you just suggested.
Not here. That was in Virginia. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about it here, although I would imagine that in some ways a population like Reddings has been dissipated by attaching it to Lancaster
had nothing to
Lancaster
do with anything
County.
Other well, than voter registration.
I don't believe it. Otherwise, we wouldn't be...
That's what they based it on.
The city of Reading wouldn't be divided into such little chunks that we have no influence.
Lancaster and parts of Chester County that were represented in the 16th district were so overwhelmingly Republican that Joe Pitts could take the hit of all the D's in the city of Reading, whereas if they were in the 6th congressional district, Jim Gerlach never would have been elected in the first place because it's the difference in numbers between R's and D's are very close.
And what's the change? We're going to stay on Capitol Hill for a bit now. The ACA and the effort to get rid of the ACA and refix it or do whatever it is. The Republicans are having one hell of a time trying to find a way through this.
When you've got people...
Or Obamacare, to the...
Well, I mean, you've got extreme conservatives who want to give up everything. You've got moderates who realize that there are things that would be wise to be kept. And you've got Democrats who aren't going to cooperate. It's going to be a tough climb.
And it goes out at the end.
But, you know, there is always a lot of hyperbole thrown in there. And we're hearing about these numbers of people that are going to lose health insurance. And those are really very fuzzy numbers. You know, there's allegedly 20 million people or something that are at risk. But there's 8.5 of the million of those people don't have any health insurance right now by their own choice. They're paying the penalty in the IRS regs and stuff because they didn't want to buy health insurance because they felt they didn't need it and are paying a penalty. That's 8.5. That's almost half of the number of people that are allegedly going to lose their health insurance.
24 million.
Well, so 8.5 million are people that are...
Are we talking about...
When you graduated from Penn State with a 215, it's pretty close. But the bottom line is that that those numbers are being manipulated to make it look a certain way.
Well,
as I see it, it is...
That
it
they're
is.
Assuming 100% participation in the health insurance
program.
Are you
program. Sure? They're not assuming...
And 8.5 million of them don't want it.
But are you sure they're only assuming against those who are getting insurance?
I believe the numbers are based on the assumption that everybody's got health insurance. Well, now, if we don't have this program, who's going to not be able to get it? And they're coming up with this number.
As I see it, the proposal is $600 billion tax relief for the wealthiest 1% disguised as a health care plan. And that really, really angers me.
I want to know what Republican in office can look into the face of a 64-year-old making $25,000 a year and tell him he can afford $14,000 for health care. Because that's what the numbers say.
But that's where we're heading right now. This thing is not sustainable as it is.
Well, then do something better than what works.
Take what works and make it better.
It's not just the cost of the health insurance, but it's these deductibles.
Who's making money in this system? The pharmaceuticals are making money. So are people who are the executives in healthcare.
Insurance companies.
Insurance companies shouldn't be getting rich because I'm ill.
I agree.
But the insurance company is getting rich because we all want protection from illness, automobile accidents, liability, all these other things.
It is because...
That's why they're getting rich.
No, it's... They're
that's why they exist.
Well, but they shouldn't.
No, that's not...
There was a time when Blue Cross and Blue Shield were not-for-profit organizations. And that's the way it ought to be.
Chuck, there's a reason that we're the only country in the developed world who has to pay for health care. The only one where private individuals have to pay to be insured for their health.
And the taxing rate against this in this country is extremely higher than those.
I wouldn't bet that in the end, that shouldn't matter.
Our taxes would have to go up exponentially to cover everybody. I think that's what your counter argument is.
Well, and will we be better off if that's the case? I mean, if I'm going to pay $10,000 for health coverage, would it be better for me to pay an extra $7,000 in taxes?
Well,
I think yes, it would be, or whatever.
Statistically, our health care costs more, double what it costs in other places that have universal health care.
But there's a lot of reasons for that thing. You can't purchase health insurance across state lines.
Yes, you can. There is no federal regulation against it. Insurance, that's true, Fred. There are no federal regulations against it.
Okay, on that note,
I'll explain to you how that works.
Fred?
Stay tuned.
Ruth?
Hey.
Take care. Thank you for joining us. We hope to see you.
Don't ask me to stop
reading, Fred. Please enjoy St. Patrick's Day for me tomorrow.
Depends on what you're reading.
Is it?